الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him, and may he bless them all, and may he bless his entire household. May he bless all those who have struggled and strived to protect the deen, to learn it, to practice upon it, to convey it to others in a way that it has come to us. Wallahi, my beloved brothers and sisters, it is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to preserve the knowledge of Islam. Because the difference between us and the others is we do not accept hearsay. We need that which is sound knowledge. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who can sacrifice at least a little bit of time to learn the deen. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it from us and to grant us every form of goodness. We saw the greatest migration or hijrah in history. In fact, it is the only one worth making mention of. And by the arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Quba, a new chapter commenced. What was the chapter? Now revelation had become known as Al-Madani, that which was revealed in Medina Munawwara, that which was revealed after the Hijrah. Up to that stage, revelation was known as Al-Makki. If you look at the surahs of the Quran, it says Surah so-and-so Makkiya, Surah so-and-so Madaniya. Did you know that the most of the surahs were already revealed in Makkah al-Mukarramah? Only 23 surahs were revealed in Medina Munawwara, although some of them were long, like Surah Baqarah and Ali Imran and so on, which were revealed in Medina Munawwara. They were quite long, but the number of surahs, the bulk of them were already revealed in Makkah al-Mukarramah, and they were discussing the topic of Tawheed, meaning the oneness of Allah, protecting ourselves from associating any form of deity with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, any god with Allah. So that was the core subject that was discussed in the verses that were revealed in Makkah al-Mukarramah. Also, as we've explained before, what is known as Imaniyat, belief in life after death, belief in heaven and hell, Jannah and Jahannam and so on. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us strength and to make us from those who are solid believers. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who appreciate the fact that we are the members of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Hijrah calendar had commenced. Now, one might ask a question, did they start counting from that point? The answer is no. At the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, later on, after the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu started recording dates, he decided that it should be commenced from the Hijrah. And this was the decision made by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Now, we learned yesterday that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrived in Quba on the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal, and it was a Monday according to some of the narrations. And according to the Christian calendar, it was approximately the 20th of September 622 AD. Approximately the 20th of September 622 AD. So the calendar had started with the first month being Muharram. Why was that? Why wasn't the first month Rabi' al-Awwal or Rabi' al-Thani? The answer to that, some of the scholars have made mention of a beautiful response. Even Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani has spoken about it, that at that time, the treaty or the pledge of Aqaba, the second one, was signed in the month of Dhul-Hijjah. And the first hijrah commenced thereafter The moon they saw after that was the moon of Muharram, so they will start counting from Muharram. So Muharram was when the Hijrah had commenced as a whole, not necessarily just the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but all his companions at large, they had started, and by that time the moon that was sighted was the moon of Muharram. So the calendar started from the first of Muharram, and this is why we have the months in that particular order in our calendar, which is the Hijrah calendar. So this is also a point, as we said, of great importance. The reason why I took some time to mention this is because it is relevant to us on a day-to-day basis, and we use this calendar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us strength. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got to Quba, as we made mention, he had stayed in the house of Al-Kulthum ibn al-Hidim, according to one narration, that was the pronunciation of the name. And this man was one of the leaders of Banu Amr ibn Auf in Quba. A few days later, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu arrived in Quba. And this is where he met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember, he was left behind in order to give whatever amanah and trust was entrusted to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by the mushriks of Mecca. And this is why he stayed back and he gave all those belongings to the people whom they belonged to. And then he proceeded to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara, and he arrived in Quba, where he met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 2 or 3 nights after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had arrived. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam loved the Ansar. The Ansar are the helpers, the people of Medina Munawwara, those who opened their homes and those who loved those who came to them. Today when we have a visitor in our home, sometimes depending on who exactly it is, we might feel for a while that, you know, this person is welcome, we're excited, and 2-3 days later it becomes a bit of a burden. Allahu Akbar, it becomes a burden. Sometimes from day one, it's a burden already, especially with the hospitality of today. But there, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not just him who was welcome, every single one of the believers, the common factor was, you utter la ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and so do we, you are welcome into our homes. And do you know what they did? Subhanallah. At some stage, they opened their doors, they shared their wealth, they shared their property, they shared absolutely everything, and they became known as brothers. Obviously, this was a little bit later on, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a few days after that, arrived in Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara from Quba, which was in the outskirts of Medina at the time. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved the Ansar so much that in Sahih al-Bukhari, there is a hadith which says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said, لَوْلَا الْهِجْرَةِ لَكُنْتُمْ رِئِمْ مِنَ الْأَنصَارِ. If it wasn't for the hijrah, I would have been a member of the Ansar. Subhanallah. Which means these people, they opened their arms to Islam, unlike the people of Quraysh, who had harmed, who had caused lots of problem and so on. All this was also for a reason known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is known to him. Sometimes we might pick up a point or two, but in most cases we wouldn't know what was the reasoning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we surrender to it, know it or not. So this was one of the narrations mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another point that is worth noting, how many days did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spend in Quba? There are some narrations which make mention of a minimum of 4 days, whereas there is a maximum of 19 days. The majority of narrations say approximately 2 weeks. So approximately 2 weeks, what happened in Quba was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam built a masjid. That would have taken a little bit of time, although it was not, as we ended off yesterday, if you remember, the question I asked right at the end about the beautification of the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At that time, the hearts of those who went to the house of Allah were beautified, but the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were simple. Nowadays, the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are beautified. Are our hearts as beautiful? That's the question I ended with yesterday. And subhanallah, it is a potent question, because it is the beautification of the heart that is achieved through the closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that will result in the solution to all our problems and difficulties. And it will drive us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us really spend some time with our own hearts, the condition of my heart. Today the difficulty is everyone's worried about the other man. He is like this, he is like that. In the process we forget about what we are and what amount of soup we are in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and grant us goodness. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam built this masjid known as Masjid Quba. And Allah has praised this masjid in the Quran. And Allah calls it لَمَسْجِدٌ أُسِّسَ عَلَى التَّقْوَى. That masjid which was built upon piety. The reason for it to be built, those who helped in it. And why it was built was piety. To bring people closer to Allah. To be a place where they could meet, where they could discuss their issues, where they could learn, where they could disseminate the knowledge they had. Where they could prepare for any attack of the enemy, where they could prepare to retaliate, and at the same time where they could pray their salah, where they could meet the messenger, where they could learn more of the Quran and the sayings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This was the role of the masjid. And this is why Masjid Quba was built, and it became a base automatically. And thereafter the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam sent message to Medina Munawwara to the Ansar that I now intend to come to Al-Madina. And then they sent delegations to pick him up, basically from amongst them some of their leaders and some of their people. And a lot of them came with some weapons because they were worried. They had encircled Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They did not want the enemy from Quraysh or the enemy from amongst the tribes who may be jealous around to harm Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So for that reason they had come and encircled him, and they took him, subhanallah. And this was a Friday. On a Friday, it is reported, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam departed, and he started going from Quba to Madinatul Munawwara. And on the way, as some of the narrations make mention, it was the time of Jumu'ah. Now As'ad ibn Zurara radiyallahu anhu, he, before Jumu'ah was made compulsory, already used to gather the Muslims on a Friday. He already used to gather the Muslims on a Friday, and they used to talk, they used to engage in ibadah and so on, read their salah. And thereafter, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was proceeding from Quba, going to Medina Munawwara, the time of that salah of Jumu'ah came into place. And he stopped at a place known as Banu Salim ibn Auf. And today, if you look at the just outside Masjid Quba, there is a little masjid known as Masjid al-Jum'ah. Some narrations say that that is where the Jum'ah took place, one of the khutbahs of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Some narrations say that was his first khutbah, the first lecture ever delivered to the Ansar and the Muhajireen was at that particular point. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, but the wording of it is very interesting. He says, oh people, he warns them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and about the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the importance to take the leader, where he says, you were like a flock without a shepherd, and Allah gave you the shepherd, and he is going to question you, what did you do? Did you follow or did you lead yourself astray? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us followers. And then he says, fear the punishment of hell, even if it means by a small piece of a date. Giving a charity by a piece of a date, not even a full date, a piece of a date. And if you cannot give that amount of a charity, then at least by a good word. Mention good words. And this shows us that your sadaqah and the charities that you give and I give, they have a role to play in saving myself and yourselves from hellfire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Many people take it for granted. The R1 or $1, R1 that we give in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that perhaps could be a means of our savior from the fire of Jahannam. So do not belittle even a single donation in the right cause towards the poor and the needy and the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us sustenance, and may he make us content. May he make us people who are happy at all times. So this was a khutbah, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then proceeded and progressed to Al-Madinatul Munawwara. And there, subhanallah, just try and picture the excitement. The people were so happy. Their messenger was coming. They had accepted Islam already. The bulk of them had accepted Islam already. They had heard so much about this man, first time meeting him. Imagine you hear so much about someone and they've really taught you so much, and now you're going to see them for the first time, subhanallah. The excitement, this was a Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the highest of creation, and he is moving, subhanallah. the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are at peace with him, starting from the clouds, to the trees, to the stones, to the animals, everything at peace with him. And he is moving with this delegation of people. And at that particular time, subhanallah, people used to climb on their roofs in order to look at what was going on. So you find the women climbing up on their roofs, and the men had rushed out, the children had rushed out. And there is a narration in Sahih Muslim which makes mention of the young boys and the youngsters of Medina Munawwara chanting a few words. The chanting of the words, Ya Muhammad, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Muhammad, these words and many other words are made mention of in the books of Hadith. And as for the books of history, and I explained yesterday the difference between the books of history and the books of Hadith. The books of history make mention of a song that we would all have heard being sung by some of the young boys and girls of Medina Munawwara, as Tala al-Badru alayna min thaniyati al-wada' wajaba ash-shukru alayna, and so on. The beautiful words, these are made mention of not in the books of Hadith, but in the books of Seerah, in the books of history. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us. Indeed, it was the dawning of a new time in the history, not only of Medina Munawwara, but of the Muslims at large. Subhanallah. And they were so happy, everyone wanting to get a glimpse. It is reported, subhanallah, that even from amongst the Jewish tribes, there were three Jewish tribes, Banu Qaynuqa', Banu Nadir, and Banu Qurayza. They were around Medina Munawwara. They had come from the Roman Empire and from the Byzantine Empire. They had come down south, and they were also informed that a messenger would come in an area described exactly as Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. And this is why they camped around there, they stayed there. They came and they heard his words. Some of them tested him by asking him questions, and many of their leaders accepted Islam. Many of the people, when they heard from amongst the Jewish people, many of them, when they heard, they accepted Islam. But obviously the bulk of the the bulk of the public of the Jews, they were waiting. They were very, very skeptical. They did not want to give in to an Arab. And they said, these are the children of Ismail. We are the children of Ishaq. Again, it went back to the ignorance and arrogance of the people of Quraysh. They did not want to accept Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because Abu Jahl says that you see the family of this Abu Talib, they have had virtue of this and that and that and the Zamzam, and now prophethood, we are not going to take it. We don't want it. We cannot give leadership to his child or his family. Subhanallah. And this is what made them deny. And this is the exact point that made the Jewish people deny Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet they were waiting for him, and they had settled in Medina Munawwara because of that. Subhanallah. And as I told you, some of their leaders, in fact a lot of their leaders, had accepted Islam. And from amongst them was Abdullah ibn Salam radiallahu anhu. We made mention of his story, and I think we should repeat it. He was from amongst those. He says, when I saw the messenger as he came into Medina Munawwara, I was busy with doing something in my little garden. I left everything and I ran. I saw his face. Obviously, he got a glimpse of it. And he says, as soon as I saw him, I knew this is not the face of a liar. Subhanallah. And he says, then I heard some of his words, and from amongst the first words that were uttered by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which were heard by Abdullah ibn Salam, something, subhanallah, أيها الناس أفشوا السلامة وأطعموا الطعام وصلوا الأرحام وصلوا بالليل والناس نيام تدخلوا جنة ربكم بسلام. If you notice the rhyming of it, obviously this is one of the narrations of the hadith. There are other wordings, but quite similar in meaning. O people, spread the salam and the peace. Live peacefully. The salam, it has a very deep meaning. It doesn't just mean peace be upon you, as in just a greeting empty of any thought. But it actually means peace be upon you from any harm from me. I won't harm you. So peace be upon you. So when we say assalamu alaikum, we mean I'm not going to harm you. Peace be upon you. Not only from me, but from all the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May you be at total peace. Imagine a dua. We are praying whenever we meet one another for one another. What greater greeting can there be? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who don't just shorten such a powerful prayer, and who can actually say it properly when we utter it, and may Allah accept it from us. So spread this salam and feed the people, feed not only the poor, but feed others, and you will find that the hearts come closer. You know, when you feed people, subhanAllah, a lot of the times what happens, it is a social event that brings people together, it makes you discuss things, it brings you closer and so on. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us hospitality, to make us hospitable people, and to make us appreciative of those who are hospitable towards us. Alhamdulillah. So he says, أطعم الطعام, feed even the poor, obviously. How many of us would be ready to invite a wealthy man or a popular man to our homes? What about the poor person who's on your street? Have you ever thought of giving him food? Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. وَصِلُوا الْأَرْحَامَ, and fulfill your relations, fulfill the link and the tie and the rights of your family members. And pray at night when everyone is asleep, because that is the most sincere. When we pray in everybody's midst, yes, there is sincerity, but perhaps we are worried about this man watching, that man watching, so the sincerity levels might not be that high. But when you are praying at night, when nobody is watching you, it's between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. May He grant us sincerity in our deeds. Then the hadith ended by saying, if you do that, you will enter the paradise of your Rabb with great ease. You will enter paradise with great ease. Abdullah ibn Salam says he came and he declared his acceptance of the Shahada. He declared that this man is indeed a messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you know the story I made mention of, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he found that this man was one of the leaders of the Jewish tribes, he told him, what about your people? He said, my people will not accept. They said, no, let us call them. So the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him to go behind a wall, called the people and asked him, who is this man in your midst? They said, he is a leader, a son of a leader, an honest man, son of an honest man, righteous person, son of a righteous, he is this and that, and they praised him. So then they were told, what if he has accepted Islam? And they said, it is impossible, he won't do that. So then when Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam called him from behind the wall and asked him, or in fact he came out and declared his shahada, that I bear witness that Allah is one and you are indeed the final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they changed their tune instantly and they said, he is a liar, son of a liar. He was a traitor, son of a traitor. He is a cheat, son of a cheat, and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from those whom when clear cut signs come in front of us, we still don't surrender. Allahu Akbar. May Allah open our doors. So this was the beauty as Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam arrived in Al-Madinatul Munawwara. And subhanallah, a beautiful day. But everyone wanted Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to come to his place. Obviously, how did the rest of the muhajirin enter the homes of the Ansar? How did the rest of the people who made hijrah enter the homes of the people of Madina Munawwara? Very simple. By what is known as qur'ah, picking lots, which means they would pick the name of the person and that particular name would go to the next Ansari who is waiting in line. So they picked the name. Nobody favored anyone and nobody chose, I will go with him, he will come with me. No, it was picked out and subhanallah, more like lots were drawn for that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us exception, meaning may He accept us. Today, if we want to solve a problem, it is also a sunnah way to actually put all your names in the hat and pick out one. There's no harm in that because it would resolve your matter. And it means nobody took anyone's chance, meaning anyone's side. I'm just thinking of something and that made me make a slip of the tongue, that sometimes if people want to cheat, they write their name 20 times. So everybody thinks that there's 20 names in there, not realizing there's only one name 20 times. When you pick it out, anyone picks it out, the same name comes. That's the type of cheating people in our time would engage in. But at that time, subhanallah, it was just. Now with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where would he go? So the narrations, there are two narrations. One makes mention of the fact that he had stopped where his camel had stopped and he asked, whose home is the closest? And Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu says, here's my home and here's its door. So he said, this is where I will stop. The other narration, which is very close in meaning, he was off his camel. And as they said, Ya Rasulullah, come to my home, and so on. He said, let my camel go. It has been instructed and it will stop wherever I should be. So the camel went a little bit and paused and sat down at a specific place. And the closest door was the door of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu. So this is how the decision was made. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then went into the house of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. He had a house which had two floors, meaning it was a double story home. And at that time, the second floor, there was no concrete between the two floors. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had entered the base, meaning the bottom floor, and Abu Ayyub al-Ansari came with his family. And he says, "Oh Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I cannot allow you to be here on this ground floor when I am going to be above you. I'm going to be above you. I can't allow that to happen. You need to go above us, because as it is, you are higher. It is a sign of respect. We would like to be below, you be above." Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, "No, I would prefer to be below, because people would come to meet me, and it would be better for the family members. Instead of people coming past, the women and everyone, as they come up to see me, rather I be at the bottom and you can be at the top without any interference." And it is reported that they were so well behaved, meaning the children and the family, they were all so well behaved that they did not want to walk in a way that would disturb Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not only that, it is reported that one of the urns that were holding water happened to fall and break there on the top floor. And immediately they got up and they tried to wipe it out so fast, because they didn't want the water to trickle down and to harm Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this narration is also made mention of in the books of hadith as well as in the books of history and seerah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who can respect this, the level of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and at the same time respect the level of the ulama, because al-ulama warathatul anbiya. The ulama are those who have inherited from the anbiya. They will have knowledge, sound knowledge. They will teach and they will relay the message of the messengers. And the treatment that people give the scholars of Islam will be similar to the treatment that people gave the messengers, because the message is one. And this is why you find societies break up into exactly the same groups of people. You have hypocrites, you have people who will support the ulama, you have people who will go down in history as those who crumbled communities because they fought the ulama, and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let us die in a condition that we are on the right side. Remember, not every time should things happen the way you want them to happen. They should always happen the way Allah and His Rasul want them to happen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Allahu Akbar. So this was the house of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiyallahu anhu. Beautiful place where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed. And in no time something else happened. There was need for a place for the Muslims to gather, because up to that stage, for a day or two, they had gathered for salah wherever they were. They had read salah. When the salah time had come in, they read it wherever they were. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose a place where the masjid would be built. And again, there is a narration of his camel being released and sitting at a specific place. That is also a narration in the books of history. So here we have a situation where a piece of land is located, and now they are looking for the owners of this land, who happen to be two young orphans from Bani Najjar. Two orphans, little boys, meaning young men, came in, and these boys, they had said, "Look, we can give this just for free," meaning we can give it as a gift, this land, although they didn't have anything. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "No, we will pay for it." And he paid for it and he gave them their price. And thereafter, the place was cleared, because there were trees there. It was like an orchard, and they had cleared the trees and so on. And they had put a little bit of a demarcation to demarcate that this is going to be the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Masjid al-Nabawi, the original structure was very small, very simple, subhanallah. And it did not take them too long to get it ready. For your information, no carpet, no marble, no tiles, no concrete. All they did was cleared it and that's it. So when they made sajda, they had marks on their knees, marks on their toes, marks on their hands, and marks on their foreheads. Subhanallah. And what type of a roof did they have? They had a roof made up of the stumps of the palm tree and a little bit of the the branches of the palm tree that were all put together and crossed together, and they had had that, and that would be the roof at that particular time. This is how it was. How high was it? It was not very high, such that a young boy, if he had to put his hand up, he would be able to touch the roof. He would be able to touch what we would term the ceiling. So it was not very high. And right next to it, with it, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had instructed the building of two rooms for his wives. Now, Sauda bint Zam'a radiallahu anha, she was the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he had married Aisha radiallahu anha before Hijra. And now, after Hijra, after some time, when they finally lived together, that was her home, Hujrat Aisha as-Siddiqa radiallahu anha, and that is the home where ultimately Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, and that is where he is buried today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson. So these houses were built very low. If you had a youngster stand up, he could actually feel the top. This is how the books have made mention of it. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they were building this masjid, they had a habit. They were so excited because they had peace for the first time. They had peace. Imagine, the gift of peace and security is one of the biggest gifts you can have. And you don't realize it until you don't have it. Or you only realize it if you have not had it in the past and now you have it. So the Muslims were so happy. They were chanting there as they're working, taking the bricks and making them. And any Sahabi who knew anything about building, there were some who had come from afar who were experts in mixing the sand and so on and making the clay. They were called in and they were helping. Subhanallah. He made use of all the experts of building, and at that particular time they were also chanting. They had this habit of chanting a few little poems as they worked. Up to today, sometimes you notice people who work very hard, they chant something, they say a few words just to make it light. Let's hope that these words are good. That time they were always good. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So these words made mention of in Sahih al-Bukhari: Allahumma la aisha illa aisha al-akhirah fansul al-ansara wal-muhajira. Oh Allah, there is no life besides the life of the Akhirah. Ya Allah, this life is nothing. The life of the Akhirah is what is important. And the dua is, so oh Allah, help the Ansar and help the Muhajirin. Help those who are from Medina, who are the helpers, and help those who have migrated all the way from Mecca and come to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. This is just one of the statements that they were uttering. Now, whilst they were building this masjid, before the masjid was completed, there was the death of one of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Who was he? His name was As'ad ibn Zurara radiallahu anhu. He passed away before the completion of the building of Al-Masjid al-Nabawi. He had met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Medina. Remember, he was from amongst those first ones who had pledged with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam once, twice, thrice, and then they came to Al-Madinah Munawwara and he passed away. Look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created him for, to support the cause. Subhanallah. So he had passed away. Another person who passed away as well was Damurah ibn Jundub. He was a person who was from Makkah al-Mukarramah. He had fallen very ill before he could make the hijrah. So he told his relatives, look, take me out. I want to make hijrah because the Prophet has instructed us to make hijrah, although I am very sick. And he passed away in Tan'im on the outskirts of Makkah al-Mukarramah. And verses were revealed in order to show the status of those who passed away whilst on the journey. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses. وَمَنْ يَخْرُجْ مِنْ بَيْتِهِ مُهَاجِرًا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ يُدْرِكْهُ الْمَوْتُ فَقَدْ وَقَعَ أَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Whosoever has come out of their homes intending the hijrah and then they pass away, their reward is written with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will get a full reward of it. Subhanallah. He was also one of those who passed away. Another member who was a senior member of the Ansar who had passed away, one of the 12 whom Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had chosen to look after the people of Medina between the pledge and the hijrah, his name was Al-Bara ibn Ma'rur. And this radiallahu anhu, he passed away in the month of Safar, just before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam had entered Quba. This man had passed away, so he did not see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam post hijrah, but he had already met him before the hijrah. He was a sahabi. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Also, who passed away? The man whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam stayed at his house in Quba, Al-Kulthum ibn Al-Hidm, or Kulthum ibn Hidm, Al-Hidm. This man, radiyallahu anhu, he passed away as well very, very soon after that, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had come into Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. Now, there is a very interesting dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam made in Medina. Medina, the weather is different from Makkah, totally different. The cold is severe. The heat is also severe. And the cold has in it, or it used to have in it, a sickness and a disease known as humma. The humma of Medina, this humma of Yathrib, in fact, it was very common and it used to kill a lot of people every year. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was told about it. These are the tough conditions of Medina Munawwara. Do you know what the hadith says to us? Man sabara ala harriha wa bardiha dakhala al-jannah. Whoever can bear patience upon the heat and the cold of Medina, Allah will grant them Jannah. So don't complain of the weather. You go there, hey, it was very hot. Hang on, just say Alhamdulillah. We are in the blessed place. That is what's important. Whether it's hot or cold is besides the point. Subhanallah. You know, I sit and I think of people, may Allah protect us. For sports, what would they do? They would buy their tickets well in advance. They would go for the whole season. And they would go to Europe even in the hottest, even if their fasts happen to have been the longest, but they will still go. And to them, they went for a purpose, to kick a ball or to watch people kicking a ball, to throw a little piece and to watch people throwing a discus and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. We have the deen. When we go to the holy lands, never ever complain about the weather. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us there again and again. Who knows, perhaps in the heat of the moment or the cold of Medina, that might be the moment of acceptance of your dua, and you might be a person who is granted Jannah because of that dua. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. So he made a dua. He says, Allahumma habib ilayna al-madinata ka hubbina makkata wa ashad. Oh Allah, make us love Medina as much as we love Makkah. Makkah is your birthplace. We all know the birthplace. You always go back there. Some people marry and they travel, but their hearts are still stuck somewhere where they were born. And when they go back there, everything seems to be greeting them. You see why? Because you look at this, hey, familiar. You look at that, familiar, mashallah. See all the smiles. I see there are some jamais that we have here as well, mashallah. Some sons-in-law perhaps that we have here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Believe me, it's a happy moment to go and see your home once again. So the hearts were connected to Rasul, to the birthplace of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which was Makkah. So now he's making a dua, oh Allah, grant us the love of Medina as we love Makkah and even more. Subhanallah. And that love has become even more. Subhanallah. In terms of spirituality, the salah and the place which is most sacred is the haram in Makkah, without a doubt. Immediately after that, the haram in Medina, without a doubt. Immediately after that, the haram in Jerusalem, without a doubt. That brings me to a point. When the masjid was built, which way was the Qibla? Interesting question. It was facing Jerusalem. We as Muslimin initially were instructed to face Jerusalem in order to create uniformity when we pray. That was it. The reason why we face a specific direction is for uniformity. We don't worship any stones or any people and so on, but it is to create uniformity. No rich man must come and say, hang on, face it towards my house. Or the other one says, you know what, I'm going to put something here, you must face it in this direction. Or, I don't like this building this way, put it this way. No, no one has a say, it's the house of Allah. He decides which way it faces. So he decided at that time, it must face Jerusalem. That was the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was built by Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam as well. In Jerusalem, you find Masjid al-Aqsa. So we used to face in that direction. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam made this dua, the continuation of the dua. He says, وَصَحِّحْهَا. Oh Allah, make it pure for us to live in. This Medina Munawwara, purify it, ya Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. From what? This disease that is in it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, وَنْقُلْ حُمَّاهَا فَاجْعَلْهَا بِالْجُحْفَى. Oh Allah, take this disease that comes in it every year and place it outside Medina Munawwara in a place known as Juhfa. And it's reported that from that time, this sickness was gone. It disappeared. People did not get sick with that humma of Yathrib thereafter. They didn't. This was a miracle of Nubuwwah, the miracle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He made a dua, and this disease, this sickness, this influenza or flu, whatever it was, which used to take the lives of so many people every year, it stopped. And it was gone out. And it went into a specific place known as Juhfa, according to the narrations in Sahih al-Bukhari. And then he made another dua. Barik lana fi sa'iha wa muddiha. Oh Allah, grant us barakah in the sustenance that is achieved here in Medina Munawwara. The wording of the dua is, grant us barakah in the measurement and in the handfuls that we give and take. Sa' is a measurement. It is actually a measurement where they used to measure when they used to give and take some of the flour and the wheat and so on. And the mud, when they used to give some other items, they used to measure it with their hands. So Ya Allah, put barakah in it. Wallahi, my beloved brothers and sisters, I need to tell you something that you can bear witness regarding. You see the dates. You can have dates from anywhere in the world, but pick up a date from Medina Munawwara, it has a different taste in it. Do you bear witness? Subhanallah. You can pick up a date from anywhere in the world. You can tell this is a Kalahari date. This is another date from elsewhere. This is an Algerian date. You can tell it. And believe me, the date of Medina Munawwara, it has a totally different taste to it and a sweetness in it. Perhaps it is this dua of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam that has granted it such barakah, because this was included in the dua mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. The hijrah was an instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everyone was instructed to fulfill the hijrah. Whoever didn't, they were sinful. The only people who were not sinful were those who were unable, either because they were blocked, they were stopped, or they didn't have the means and so on. But if people were able to fulfill the hijrah and they did not, they were sinful. So the hijrah was farad. It was compulsory upon all. The bulk of the people had actually made hijrah. In fact, at some stage when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had settled down in Al-Madinatul Munawwara, he sent, subhanallah, Zayd ibn Haritha and Abu Rafi' to Mecca to collect the rest of his and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu's families. So who came all together? Fatima, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his other daughter Umm Kulthum. And Sauda, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ibn Zam'a radiallahu anha. Umm Ayman, the second mother of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We made mention of her at the beginning of these episodes when we spoke about the woman who looked after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By this time she was married to Zayd ibn Haritha. Zayd ibn Haritha was the one who went to go and collect them. And I think I made mention of this incident that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever wants to marry a woman from paradise should marry Umm Ayman. And Zayd ibn Haritha married her. He was as fair as anything in complexion, and she was dark in complexion, being from Africa. And he did not even doubt. The minute Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever wants to marry a woman from paradise should marry Umm Ayman, he married her, and they had a blessed child, Usama ibn Zayd, who was born just before the hijrah, and he had also been brought into Medina Munawwara together with his mother, Umm Ayman, and the Usama ibn Zayd. As for Zainab, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was married to a man known as Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi'. He did not accept Islam and he stopped his daughter from going through the hijrah. So she was from amongst those who was excused at that particular time. Together with them, the family of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Umm Ruman radiallahu anha, the wife of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Aisha radiallahu anha, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Asma'a binti Abi Bakr, who was the wife of Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiallahu anhu. And this Asma'a, she was pregnant. And when she came into Medina Munawwara, she delivered a child whose name was Abdullah ibn al-Zubayr, the son of Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiallahu anhu. This man, remember this name, Abdullah ibn al-Zubayr, the grandchild of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and the son of Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, the son of Asma binti Abi Bakr. He was the first to be born from amongst the Muhajirin after the hijrah. Amazing. So this was the first child of the Muhajirin born in Medina Munawwara. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us blessing. Wallahi, it is the city of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and indeed it is a very, very blessed city. We can feel it from the outskirts as we are drawing near, the calmness, the serenity. This is just the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these were the people who had come through, and Abdullah, the son of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, had also come through. What had happened is the masjid was now built, the people were settling in. There were a few conditions around in Madinatul Munawwara. Perhaps we will divulge, meaning we will expand on it tomorrow by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But today we want to make mention of the history of Adhan. Because Adhan is the call which is called to the prayer. They used to get together for the time of prayer and they sat to discuss with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what should we do to remind the people it's prayer time? So some people suggested, let us raise a flag when it's prayer time. And then they said, no, we don't want to do that for whatever reason. And perhaps this flag, it's not one of our ways of doing things. Then some of them suggested, okay, let's light a fire. So the smoke will go around and we will be able to let the people know that this is now the time of salah. They disagreed with that as well. We don't light fires. Then they said, okay, let us blow in a bugle. They said, no, we won't blow a bugle because that is the way of the non-believers. Then they said, okay, why don't we hit on a bell or we ring a bell, subhanallah. Then they said, no, that is the Christian way of calling towards prayer, so we won't do that. And one of them had suggested that, why don't we call the people? We just call them. So Abdullah ibn Zayd al-Ansari was one of those who used to call the people for salah, but with no specific wording. He just used to go out at the time of salah and remind the people, come for salah, and so on, salah, salah, and they would call the people through. And later on, this was known as tathweeb. Tathweeb was after the adhan, when we go out and we tell people, come, let's go for salah, salah. That is a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, this man, Abdullah ibn Zayd al-Ansari, radiallahu anhu, he saw a dream. Just within a few days, he saw a dream. And in the dream, a man came to him and told him, why don't you utter these words? And taught him the adhan, exactly as we know it today. Allah is the greatest. I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship but Allah. I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his messenger, his worshipper. Come for success, for salah, come for success. Allah is definitely the greatest. There is none worthy of worship besides Allah. These are the words of the call to prayer. So when he got up, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he told him the dream. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells him, innaha la ru'ya haqq. Indeed, it is a true dream. I've already been given revelation with these exact words. Now comes the important part. Very important point we need to learn. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looks at him and says, laqqin dhalika bilalan fa innahu anda sawtan mink. Go and teach these words to Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu anhu, because he has a much more beautiful and louder voice than yours. Amazing. What do we learn from this? We learn that the muadhin needs to be a person who has a beautiful voice, who calls the adhan in a way that automatically attracts people towards the salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. And may he make us from those whom when we call the adhan, everybody comes. Amazing. You see, when you have an adhan and it's powerful and it's called well, people listen to it. The non-believers listen to a beautiful adhan. They wait for the next one. I have had people who know me who told me that, you know, this particular masjid, we actually wait and listen to this call. It's so sweet. We don't even know what it means, but we get so much sweetness out of listening to the beauty of it. And we know the tune because obviously, you know, the muadhins are known for their tunes. They stick normally to one particular tune, each person. And that would actually sound not only in this world, but even in the akhirah, subhanallah. The hadith says those who will have the tallest or the longest necks, they will be the most conspicuous on the day of judgment, will be al-muadhinun, those who used to call out adhan. They will be known from a distance. Why? Conspicuous, very high. Why will they be so high? The hadith says, لَوْ يَعْلَمُ النَّاسُ مَا فِي النِّدَاءِ وَالصَّفِّ الْأَوَّلِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَجِدُوا إِلَّا أَن يَسْتَهِمُوا عَلَيْهِ لَاسْتَهَمُوا. If the people had known the value of calling out the adhan and the value of standing in the first saf, then if they couldn't do it, they would actually draw lots in order to pick up who is the one who's going to be there. That's how serious it is. And that's how well virtue, or that's how highly virtuous it is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant it to us. Did you know that the muadhin gets the full reward of everyone who came to the masjid, all their salahs? So if we are 700 people here, for example, the muadhin gets 701 salahs rewards for that one salah. Why? He called them to the prayer. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. And sometimes we find ourselves treading all over these people and we don't even realize their value. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us paradise, and may He grant them paradise too. So Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu anhu was told, and subhanallah, he started calling the prayer. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah. Beautiful call to prayer. And we know it to this day. Bilal ibn Rabah was the one who started uttering these words. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had two main muadhins. One was Bilal, and the other one, do you remember we made mention of him? Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum, the blind man. Subhanallah. Radiyallahu anhum jami'an. May Allah be pleased with them, all of them. It's important for us to know these names. We're going to meet these people. It's important for us to know these names and to be able to recognize these people by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Bilal ibn Rabah, in the Fajr prayer, he added something. What did he add? As-salatu khayrun minan nawm. Subhanallah. Salah is better than sleep. Prayer is better than sleep. He added that. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam aqarrahu ala dhalik. He said, yes, that is correct. You can say it. So up to today, for the Fajr prayer, we add that, subhanallah. Now it's important for us to know that the Jumu'ah prayer had one adhan. Later on, at the time of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, he introduced another second adhan, which was also from above. They used to call it from the top, a high place. At that time, there were no minarets as we have them today, nor were they loud hailers as we have them today. But they used to call it from the top, above. And they used to call it in a way that everyone could hear. So Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu decided that, look, we want to call the people, so let us call them through, for Jumu'ah, another adhan. So he introduced a second adhan outside. And Hisham ibn Abdul Malik, later on in the Amawi Empire, he is the one who told that muadhin, come inside and stand in front of the imam. So the adhan that we have in front of the imam that happens on a Friday is actually the original adhan for Jumu'ah, but it was brought into the masjid by Hisham ibn Abdul Malik. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness, and may He make us from those who know the history of the adhan. Also, in Ramadan, a lot of the narrations make mention of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam having had two adhans for Fajr. One would wake up the lazy for suhoor, and the other one would actually get the people in for Salatul Fajr. And this is why to this day you find in a lot of the Middle Eastern countries in Ramadan, they have an early adhan, which is actually getting you up for tahajjud and at the same time telling you it is now time for suhoor, and then you have another adhan that is for Salatul Fajr. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Inshallah, tomorrow we will go through more of what happened in the initial stages in Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara before we go into the difficulties that were faced once again at the hands of Quraysh and the enemies of Islam. Until then, we say, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad, subhanallah bihamdih, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, maliki